Good morning, Kahal Kadosh, Shavua Tov Umevorach. Today, the 23rd day of Sivan, corresponding to the 15th day of June 2020. Today's class, graciously sponsored by our esteemed friend and member, Mr. Clemon Beda Hamwi Akohen, Le'ilui Nishmat, his beloved wife, Doret Batsofi, Yiratzonda, to the words of Torah, may be an aliyah to her beautiful neshama. Amen. We left last week Pirkei Avot, and we begin today Mishnah number 13, or 12, depends on the text that the Kahal may be following. Let me just open up here quickly. In other books, this will be Mishnah 9. In the ones that I'm using, also has it as Mishnah 12. So chapter 2, or actually Mishnah 13. Amar lahem, Rabbi Yohanan ben Zakkai, or Rabban Yohanan ben Zakkai, says to his students, Se'u ur'u, go out and see, Ezohi derech tova, she'idbak bah ha'adam. See what is the nice way or a good way in life that a person should cling to. In other words, make it a way of life. Rabbi Eliezer Omer, Rabbi Eliezer says, Ayin Tova, a good eye, meaning to say, tolerance and benevolence towards others. Beautiful. Rabbi Yoshua Omer, Haver Tov, being a good friend, getting a good friend, because friends at the end of the day influence somehow the life of a person. Rabbi Yossi Omer, Shachen Tov. Rabbi Yossi says, a good neighbor. Why? A good neighbor, to a certain extent, has more influence on the person than a good friend. Why? Because a good neighbor, due to the proximity that the person has, mean the future like a prophet. It means a person that can see the outcome or the consequences of their actions. Rabbi Elazar Omer, Lev Tov. Rabbi Elazar says to have a good heart. Why? Because the good heart is the stimulus package that the person needs to have in order to develop good midot and ma'asim tovim, as we're going to learn now from the commentaries. Amar lahem, Rabbi Yohanan ben Zakkai says to his students, Ro'e ani, I see, he says, Edivre Elazar ben Arach, the words of Elazar ben Arach, who said, Leftov, midivrechem, shevichlal devarav, divrechem, that in his word of having a good heart includes a good friend, a good neighbor, seeing the consequence of the action, and having benevolence and tolerance towards others. In other words, what the great Rabbi Yohanan ben Zakkai is saying is that everybody concentrated on one a specific concept. Rabbi Elazar ben Arach was an all-inclusive concept. With that being said, we are going to learn some of the beautiful commentaries on this particular Mishnah. Excuse me for a second, please. I'd like to close the door. So let's go really to read quickly the Mefarshim on this particular Mishnah. Comes the great Rabbeinu Yonah, and it says, what is Rabbi Yohanan Ben Zakkai message that he's trying to convey through this Mishnah. So the great Rabbeinu Yonah says as follows. There are many midot, good midot, that a person can develop throughout life. There are many midot. I mentioned in the past, there is a sefer called Orchot Tzaddikim, and this is a book of Musar. The author is unknown, but there he describes different midot that a person has. Some of them are positive, some of them are negative, and they're all together, I think, like 24 or 25, I believe. And there gives you the positive and the negative. So because we have so many, so what do you think Rabbi Yohanan ben Zakkai is asking his students? That a person should concentrate to make it their way of living. So comes the first one. Rabbi Eliezer says, Ayin Tova. Remember, Ayin Tova mentioned a good eye. What does it mean, a good eye? So Rabbeinu Obadiah of Bartenura and the Meiri, they say, Istapek ha'adam b'ma sheyesh lo. Be happy with whatever you have. Beismach betovat zulato. But we also be happy in the success of your fellow men. Because a person that is A, happy with whatever they have, and is happy with somebody else's success, comes the Meiri and it says that this helps to develop such a great personality on the person that there is another benefit that comes. The concept of tolerance, the concept of benevolence, and the person develops this beautiful character trait that, according to the Rabbi Eliezer, this is fundamental for the life of the person. Comes Rabbi Yoshua, and it says, as I said, Haver Tov. So Rabbeinu Obadiah of Bartenura, the master commentator on the Mishnah, one of the main ones, he says that a person needs to have a good friend in order to rebuke him when things are not done in the proper way. We discussed this topic in the past. The topic of rebuking someone is actually a mitzvah from the Torah, but a very dangerous mitzvah. Yes, why dangerous? Because if God forbid the rebuke is not done properly, it could turn into a disaster, it could turn into a mahloket. And that's why the Mishnah says that this fellow, Rabbi Yoshua, says this individual has not been done, feel free to approach me. That is a whole different level of rebuke. I think that the danger element of rebuke is when this is not done and the person just decides to pick on people and to say you did this wrong, etc. That is the dangerous element of rebuke. But if somebody tells you, Rabbi, please do me a favor, anytime you see me doing something that I can do better, come and tell it to me. Obviously, you have to do it out of love, you have to do it in a respectful way, and you have to pick the right time, when to say it and when not to say it, etc. But Rabbi Yoshua says, if you have someone that is going to be like your Mashkiach, that can help you grow spiritually, there is no better investment to have in your life. Not only that, Rabbeinu Yonah explains that to be a good friend, to have good camaraderie, it helps the person to also develop a good reputation. אז רבי עקיבא סס, באהבת לרעך כמוך. Love your fellow man as you love yourself. Although according to some opinions, when the pasuk says re'acha means your wife, which obviously makes a lot of sense, but also means your friend. You have good friends, good influence in your life. Rabbi Yossi Omer, Shachen Tov. Be a good neighbor. And this is not a State Farm insurance commercial. Be a good neighbor. Is actually a Talmudic from the Mishnah in Pirkei Avot. Because at the end of the day, we live with our neighbors. Especially for those who live in apartment buildings or in condominiums, that you have tenants and you have residents in the same floor. So you need to activate the good neighbor policy. But not only that. It says here, the Rabbeinu Yonah, that how do you develop being a good neighbor? You know what he says? A person that talks properly to anyone that comes in close encounter with. In other words, for those of us who live in condominiums, we see people constantly. When you live in a private home, the way some people do elsewhere, so you park your car, you go to your house, and halas, you didn't see anybody else. A person who lives in a condominium, you drop the car by the valet. And the valet, you give the key to the valet. And then you see the person behind the desk, the concierge. So that's already two chances or two opportunities for us to say good morning, good evening, thank you so much. Simple, in and out. Doesn't have to be a whole derasha. And then in the morning, you leave your apartment, you see the concierge, good morning, have a great day. You see the valet, thank you very much. Obviously, if you live in the condominium, I don't think you have to tip him every time because it's part of your maintenance, but occasionally you take care of them. And guess what? When you greet somebody and you say good morning or good night and thank you so much, have a great day, these small things, it creates good spirit and good feelings, not only for the person that you said it to, but also to ourselves. And that's what Rabbeinu Yonah, in a way, explains. Benimsa ohev be'ahuv. Not only the person is showing respect towards others, but others also develop respect towards the person because you acknowledge them, even that is in early morning. Now, there is a second opinion that says that a person should always have a friend accessible. Accessible for an advice, accessible to open the heart. In our days, this friend sometimes becomes a rabbi, that a rabbi advises people. And everybody should feel close enough to the rabbi to feel comfortable to ask for an advice or to ask a question. And it says that part of the mission of a friend is the topic of Idud. Idud literally means to encourage. To encourage the person to do better. To encourage the person to do more. To encourage the person to go one more step. Like exercise. Like rehab, hamavdil, in a physical way. What they tell you? One more step, you can do it. One more step, come on, one more, beautiful. What the guy did, just took one step. True, but in that condition, taking one step, it's like running a marathon. What made him do it? Obviously his goodwill to live, but also the pushing of the therapist. If the therapist says, oh, you're tired today? Okay, go to sleep, take a nap. And the next day, the same way, what do you think? The person is going to be rehabilitated physically? That's why they push you. And that's what the Mishnah says. The concept of giving encouragement to people it goes to a tremendous amount of distance to benefit the individual. Not only that, I remember the Gemara in Berachot says, whoever, and obviously I'm talking in a general way, we're not talking about today's challenging situations, that people may not come still to synagogues to pray for many different reasons. But I'll tell you the following, that the Gemara writes in Masechet Berachot, a person that has a synagogue to pray, accessible synagogue near the home to go pray, and doesn't go to pray, it's called Shachen Ra. It's called a bad neighbor. That's the language of the Talmud. Here we say Shachem Tov. Here we say a good neighbor. But the question is, why the Gemara calls the fellow who has a synagogue next door to the home and doesn't go to pray, that he's not a good neighbor? What did he do? He's praying at home. He says, exactly. When a person prays at home, he doesn't give a good example, not to his children and not to the next door neighbor. Because he says, oh, if he's staying at home, I'm also going to stay at home. So what happened? That other person wanted to come to shul, but because he saw him praying at home, he says, you know what? If he prays at home, I also going to pray at home. And this is how the influencing of the neighbor becomes out of a negative and not of a positive. Rabbi Shimon Omer, Haro'e et Hanolad, a person is going to see what's going to be developing. And Rabbeinu Obadiah brings, and it says, he's able to calculate what's going to be the benefit or the detriment based on the decision a person makes. This includes food, sleeping habits, and everything else, going to places, etc. And that's why it says a person needs to become a mini Navi, so to speak, and to be able to determine it is good decision that I'm making, and if I make this decision today, what's going to be 3 months from now? What's going to be 6 months from now? What's going to be 20 years from now? As we discussed in the early class today, the concept of marriage. Hopefully marriage is a one-way ticket. So the person needs to have enough siyata dishmaya, heavenly help, but also common sense to make sure that this relationship that he's about to commit as marriage is something that is a working relationship and is something that together, husband and wife, will be able to build a beautiful home. And that's why the Mishnah says you need to make your homework, you need to do your due diligence and to see what the future will bring. Sometimes it's better to say no today and not say no later on in life. And sometimes it's important to say yes now, because the future, God willing, will be getting only better and better. Now, the last one, Rabbi Elazar says, Lev Tov. Person stem from the heart. Umi shelibo tov. And a person that has a good heart, kol midotav tovot, all the midot are good. And for that reason, Rabban Yohanan ben Zakkai says to his students, I see that the words of Rabbi Elazar ben Arach are all inclusive, meaning to say, everything depends on the heart. And he dissects the Mishnah. A person that has a good heart, all their midot, all the way of thinking are in the proper way. A good heart has happiness, and happiness transfers into I'm happy with my life. I am happy with the biracha that Hashem gave me. As actually is a pasuk in the Torah that I mentioned yesterday, I believe. Besamachta bechol atov asher natan lecha Hashem Elokecha. Be happy with all the good that Hashem gave you. One opinion explains, Besamachta bechol atov, be happy with all the goodness that God gave you, and tov elaisha, This refers to marriage. Shlomo HaMelech writes, Masa Isha, Masa Tov. This is beautiful pirush, that a person should be happy with the wife that Hashem gave us. What does it mean? That many times a person may say, oh, perhaps if I would have married somebody else, things could be different. Forget about it. Has v'shalom. That thought should never cross the mind of a Yehudi. V'samachta b'chol hatov. It's a pasuk in the Torah. It's not a midrash. God forbid, we're not minimizing the midrash. It's a pasuk black and white in Sefer Devarim. V'samachta b'chol hatov asher natalecha Hashem Elokecha. Be happy with the wife that Hashem gave you. As Shlomo HaMelech says, Re'e chayim im ha'isha asher natata imari. I see my life with the wife that you gave me. Meaning to say that every husband not only loves his wife, as the great Rabbi Akiva said a few moments ago, Be'aftalo re'acha kamocha ze kelal gadol batorah. When you love your wife like you love yourself, guess what? Your Shalom Bayit problems will disappear. And once your Shalom Bayit is in the right track, nobody stops you. You live a happy life. You be in a happy mode. Your heart will be good. Because you have love. And love is ahava. Love is echal. Love is one. You unite your soulmate, so to speak. So it says, Umi she'u ba'al lev tov. And a person that has a good heart, then his behavior is proper. His happiness is there. He's happy with somebody else's success. He becomes a good friend. He becomes a good neighbor. He has benevolence. Ayin tova means benevolence, abundance, generosity, tolerance, etc. And also, because of the good heart, Rabbeinu Yonah says, now you can see things above and beyond. Let's say I'm looking at the wall behind me. Many people may see a wall, but people who understand there is wallpaper, sheetrock, metal studs, fireproofing, soundproofing, whatever requirement the city has. That's the difference. You see behind the wall. And that's exactly what the Mishnah says. You have peripheral vision. You're able to see everything from all angles. And then you said, you know what? Based on this circumstance, no. Many times people ask questions. And sometimes the question is about moving. Rabbi, we would like to move to your neighborhood. Or Rabbi, we would like to move to make Aliyah to Israel. Or Rabbi, we have a job offer and we have 3 different cities where to go. Now, why people come to the rabbi? Because the rabbi, A, most likely will not be emotionally involved in the decision that you need to make. But the rabbi, with Hashem's help and a bit of Yirat Shamayim and a bit of Sechel, will be able to put the cards on the table and start asking the right questions. Okay, you want to move. Okay, I'm sure you have your reasons why you need to move, etc. Is there a community? Is there education for your children? How is kosher food? Is there a mikveh for your wife? Is there a good rabbi that you can connect to? In other words, these questions, everyone needs to ask themselves. But sometimes people look at the quality of life, at the job offer, whatever that means, and then there is a nice synagogue there. But that's not enough. To have a nice synagogue is not enough. A synagogue is beautiful. Don't get me wrong. But if you come, especially from a good, strong, background, or you come from a solid community, like our communities are in the north or in the south, all solid communities with minyanim, with Torah, with mikveh, with classes, with Talmud Torah, with kolelim, and everything that we need. And then you're going to go to a place that is not the way it should be. Maybe today you say, no, it's a low cost of living and a great salary. True. But guess what? You're sacrificing your children. What's going to be with your children? What kind of friends they're going to have? What kind of environment they're going to have? And this is something that the Mishnah seems to insinuate in the concept of Haro'eh Tanolad, that a person that can see a bit more than just, oh, a job offer to move. And that's the reason why Rabbeinu Obadiah, Mehila, Rabbeinu Yonah says that Lev Tov, it also includes the thinking of the future. Not only today, but what's going to be the future? What's going to be the next generation or the next year when the kids need environment, that the family needs to have more of a holy and a proper surrounding, etc. And that's what the great Rabbi Yochanan ben Zakkai loved, the statement of Rabbi Elazar ben Arach. So we have the next Mishnah, which in some books are separated Mishnayot. But now we're going to do something that we don't really do often, because Baruch Hashem, that's not our personality, thank God. But today is going to be an exception. Today we are going to talk about, like this first Mishnah was all about positive statements, now we're going to switch the two. Now we're going to concentrate on negative situations. What should stay away from? So comes the Mishnah and it says, Amar lahem, now comes the great Rabbi Yochanan ben Zakkai and says to his students, Tzeur'u, go out and see, Ezohi derech ra'a, what is the evil path, the negative path, sheitrahek mimena ha'adam, that a person should distance themselves. Yani, what are the situations that we need to avoid at all cost? Very interesting Mishnah. And I repeat, we usually try to concentrate on the good. But sometimes we need to understand what to stay away from. Rabbi Eliezer Omer, Ayin Ara, an evil eye. How do you develop Ayin Ara? Could be a few options. Number one, complaining constantly, not being happy with your blessing, and always looking at the next door neighbor, or always looking at someone else. Another way to activate Ayin Ara, the Tosafot writes, I don't remember in which volume, but we learned it in the Daf Yomi a while back, is when the person attracts attention to themselves. Meaning to say, a person creates a situation of jealousy from others. Let's go. Rabbi Yoshua Omer, Haber Ra, a bad friend, because he will have negative influence. And this is something that is on, there is not something that we never heard of it. The opposite. Many times people say, all my friends do it. Or sometimes a person says, I'm embarrassed of my friends. Rabbi Yossi Omer, Shachen Ra, a wicked neighbor. Rabbi Yoshimon Omer is interesting. Halove ve'eno meshalem, a person who borrows and does not pay back. Ehal halove min ha'adam, one, a person borrows from another person. Kelove min ha'makom, is that the person is borrowing from Hashem. What does it mean? Who gave you the loan? You may say, my friend Moshe. Says, yeah, Moshe gave you the check. But who put in the mind of Moshe to give you the loan? HaKadosh Baruch Hu. Ah, so now if you're not paying back, We're not paying back a Kadosh Baruch Hu, so to speak. Sheneemar, Loveh Rasha Velo Yeshalem, Besadik Honen Venoten. The wicked borrows and does not pay back. But the righteous is generous and gives. Rabbi Eliezer Omer Levra, a wicked heart. Amar Lahem, Rabban Yohanan said to the students, Roe Ani, Edivre Elazar Ben Arach, Shemidivrechem, Shemichlal Devarav Divrechem. I see that the words of Rabbi Elazar Ben Arach are all encompassing, meaning to say that if a person has a good heart, automatically the person, his heart will not tell him to be a good friend or a good neighbor, and jealousy would be his middle name, and paying back is something that he doesn't do. This is the literal translation of this Mishnah. We're not going to go further in the Mishnayot, but I think it's imperative that we open this Mishnah for a few minutes with your permission to understand the things that we need to stay away from. We already learned what are the things that I need to gravitate to. Now, we need to build a wall. Like the president mentioned, a wall in Mexico border, not the Seattle wall. I don't understand there, but that's what's happening as of today. We hope that sanity and calmness comes into everyone's mind with Hashem's help. So let's go. The commentaries al Rabbeinu Obadiah of Bartenura brings this question. Why is there a need to have a Mishnah that concentrates on the negative after the Mishnah of the positive? That's something that I can learn by myself. What's the purpose of this Mishnah? So here the Rabbeinu Obadiah explains that not always the opposite is bad. For example, there is a concept, and we learned this together, maybe last class, in the Pirkei Avot. What does it mean to be a Hasid? So we explain that although in the 21st century, to be a Hasid means belonging to a certain Hasidic group, so to speak, but from a Torah perspective, to be a Hasid, you don't need to be part of a Hasidic group. You can be a Hasid and be Sephardic. You're doing bad. And this is the example that everybody brings. A person that is a Hasid, a person that goes above and beyond the letter of the law, or somebody who just follow the letter of the law. That's beautiful explanation of Rabbeinu Obadiah of Bartenura. On the other hand, his tapkut, to be content with what we have, it's great. But let's say that you want to do a bit better for your family. You don't want to drive your grandfather's Oldsmobile, Alava Shalom, the Oldsmobile. You want to drive a Lexus. You want to buy, you want to drive a whatever minivan exists today. Does it mean that you cannot get a minivan for your family? Does it mean that you cannot get an SUV? Or because your father didn't have ABS and power bag and power windows and power locks, so you're going to get a manual window? It doesn't exist. So Rabbeinu Obadiah of Bartenura says that being content, it's a great midah to have. But if you want to do a bit better to give more comfort to your family, go ahead, do it. But if your intention of doing it is to show that guy or to show somebody else how great you are doing, you don't care about your family, You care about how your external appearance will be in front of the world. That is Ayin Hara. Very interesting perspective from the Mishnah. Now, before we go to the final part of this Mishnah, let's read the commentaries quickly on this particular part. So we mention Ayin Hara. Ayin Hara develops jealousy, envy, and eventually hatred. And the person may come and do things just to satisfy their need of jealousy and envy from others, including lack of honesty in business and all the matters which are irrelevant to that topic. Rabbi Yoshua Omer, Haver Ra. Haver Ra, it says that a person decisions many times get influenced by others. And if that influencing it comes from a negative source, that could be a disaster for the person's life. And I think that we all agree on that. In English or in Spanish or in Hebrew, they tell you, tell me who you go with, I tell you who you are. And let's clarify that the friends that we are talking about, it doesn't mean the friend that you go to eat in a restaurant once a week or once a month, whenever restaurants were open to eat there. We're talking about people that have the power of influencing our life. Sometimes you want to gravitate to people that are successful financially, but spiritually are empty. But that financial success becomes like a magnet. You believe that you're going to attach yourself to them, and some of their success may come to you. It's possible. Nobody is denying that. But I think that the Mishnah is trying to tell us is, don't make the financial success or the glamour or the lifestyle of the rich and famous as your main goal in life. You're living for them. You're not living for yourself then. And that's why the Mishnah writes, Shachen Ra. It says, there are neighbors that are not good people. And you heard stories like this. I'm not going to say the words, but I'm sure you heard stories that how neighbors make other neighbors' lives very difficult and very challenging, and they're always complaining, and they're never happy, etc. So the Mishnah also is telling us, you know, that we say in the Birkot HaShachar, Arhek Mishachen Ra, move away from them, so they don't influence our life in an adverse fashion. Now, you may ask yourself, Rabbi, so far, every Mishnah, every sentence of the Mishnayot that we learned today, the positive and the negative, they said, Ayin Tova, Ayin Ra'a, a good eye, negative eye, a good neighbor, a bad neighbor, a good friend, a negative friend, a good heart, a negative heart. But then suddenly, from the fellow who said before the concept of Haro'et HaNolad, suddenly, Rabbi Shimon, now you're telling me about the concept of loans. What has to do taking a loan from someone with the concept of seeing what's going to be in the future? So here explains that this is exactly the opposite of seeing the future. And it says that a person may borrow and he may not have how to pay back. And if the person builds a reputation that he borrows and doesn't pay back, when he's going to need, what people are going to say? You don't have enough credit. Nobody wants to co-sign for you. I tell you as a rabbi that many times we need to deal or settle financial disputes, financial matters. And one of the comments that I get from people is, Rabbi, he should have told me that he cannot pay me $500 a month. I'll be happy if he pays me $50 a month, $100 a month. It will take five times, but you know what? At least I see the honesty of the person that is willing to make a goodwill, but he doesn't answer my phone calls. He avoids me. And when I send them emails or messages, they bounce. And that's part of the Mishnah here. It says that a person borrows and doesn't pay, how is he going to be able to survive in the future when the truly need comes to the person? And that's why the Mishnah says, not only that a person that borrows and doesn't pay, it's acting wrong against the person who did the chesed towards the person and lended the money. But if he doesn't, kelove min hamakom, is actually borrowing from God and is not paying. And the pasuk has a nice a set of words to describe those who don't pay versus those that borrow and pay. The Mishnah writes clearly from the Tehillim, check it out, chapter 37, verse 21, Love Rasha velo yeshalem, the borrower who borrows and doesn't pay, it's considered an evil person. Why? Because not only that he's not paying back the loan, but actually the person fulfill a mitzvah from the Torah by lending him money and definitely not charging interest. And now you're causing suffering to the lender. And whatever side effects may come across the person's life. And that's why when people ask me, Rabbi, this person is asking me for a loan, can I lend it to him, So my first question is, what happens if he doesn't pay it back to you on time? Do you need this money immediately? Can you afford that there is a little delay? Can you ask for a guarantee or guarantor? Is there a document? All these questions I'm giving the lender or the investors to think and to digest, to make an intelligent decision if they can afford to lend or not. And Bad the Sadiq, Honen Venoten, Borei Olam gives, and that's why Rabbi Elazar says, Lev Ra, a person that God forbid has a negative eye, unhappy heart, an evil heart, so to speak. It's inclusive of all of the negative above. Ki adam shelibo ra. Because a person, God forbid, that has a bad heart, emotionally I mean, af eino ra'a. His eye also, because the fact that there is bitterness in the heart, so everything the person sees is surrounded by a certain aura of darkness. Hence, jealousy, lack of tolerance, lack of patience, envy, and everything that goes around. Bechol ma'asav mekulkalim bera'im. And it also has a domino effect on all the actions of the person. As the Yalkut Shimoni says, Belotaturu ahare levavchem beahare einechem. Don't follow your heart, don't follow your eyes. From here we learn the Yalkut Shimoni says that the eye follows the heart. That's what the Mishnah began, Ayin Ra. I'm not referring to that. I'm referring to the good people of Am Yisrael that have the power to influence our life and help us to live a holier and a meaningful life. Once again, we'd like to take the opportunity to say a big Chazak Baruch to our dear friend and member, Mr. Clemon Rahamim Veda Hamuya Kohen, for graciously sponsoring today's class, Le'ilui Nishmat, his beloved wife, Toret Bat Sofi, Aleha Shalom. Have a great day, everybody. Shavua Tov, u'mevorach to everyone.